evening and welcome to Maryville College's 204th Founders Day celebration. On behalf of Maryville College and our over 10,000 alumni, I am honored and delighted to welcome you tonight. My name is Liz Harvey, and I'm currently a sophomore majoring in psychology with counseling and a minor in business. I'm also involved in Student Programming Board, MC Crime Talk, the Playhouse Scholarship, and serve as a resident assistant. I will be serving as your MC for the evening, so let's get this showcase started. Please welcome Maryville College's 12th president, Dr. Brian Coker, to the stage.
Good evening, everyone. Y'all know me, come on. Good evening.
Good evening.
All right, good evening, fellow members of the Maryville College Scotts family. It's wonderful to see this auditorium filled with Maryville College alumni, friends, supporters, faculty, staff, and our students. Welcome back to College Hill, and welcome one and all to this annual Founders Day celebration. Homecoming weekend is off to quite the celebratory start. Already, our football alumni gathered for lunch and a scouting report with head coach Ben Fox. Milestone reunion classes have begun gathering, and we've hosted two volleyball matches as well. We brought back the President's Circle reception this year, and just moments ago, my wife Sarah and I had the privilege of speaking with many of you, some of our most generous donors. The Maryville College spirit, it is soaring high tonight, and it makes me so proud to be serving as your 12th president. Homecoming is a very, very special time here on this campus. It's an annual event that this college has planned and hosted for nearly a century now. And Founders Day in recent years has been a gathering of Maryville College's most generous donors and our board members. However, this year, with this new format, we strive to be more inclusive and to recognize the contributions of even more Maryville College supporters. We're very excited about this format tonight and hope that it will be the way we celebrate Founders Day for years to come. And of course, we're quite excited to see and for you to see the artistic talent developed and fostered in our students and our alumni with performances scheduled throughout tonight's program. Actually, we're excited about a lot here at Maryville College right now, and I want to share with you some of our recent successes. We welcomed 1,147 students to the college this fall. Yeah, I'll take it, come on. Our first-year student enrollment is the highest it's been in 7 years, bucking a trend at several schools like us. Lots of Maryville College faculty and staff were instrumental in bringing these students in. But I'll lift up our amazing admissions team for a particularly valiant effort, an effort that continues. Because as we look to next fall, 24, we're currently up 30% in our admissions applications. Can't beat that. All of these students are going to have a meaningful, enriching educational experience. We promised this for two centuries, but let me mention some specific improvements. Next year, we will open the Maryville College Downtown Center at the corner of Court and Church Streets in downtown Maryville, in a building that some of you may remember as the old J&K Grocery and Feed Store. Perhaps some of you remember. This will become the beautiful home of our new hospitality and regional identity, as well as the fermentation sciences program. Yes, that's beer brewing. And it will also position the college as a visible stakeholder in a developing historic downtown area. Construction has recently been delayed. Anyone here from the city of Maryville in the permitting office? I'm just kidding. But we should start on the inside the build out any day now. Construction has been occurring this year in Cooper Athletic Center too. The volleyball and men's and women's basketball teams now have modern locker rooms that are befitting these championship programs. I encourage you to step into Boydson Baird Gym tomorrow to cheer on our volleyball team, and you'll see a brand new video scoreboard and digital score table. The gym has experienced pretty much a total renovation, with the exception of a new hardwood floor on the main court, for which we are still fundraising. Just wanted to point that out. Susie Booker, Advancement VP, is glad to talk with anyone interested in that opportunity. I'm proud to report that few gymnasiums in the NCAA Division III rival ours, and we're so proud of that. We're currently in the midst of our reaffirmation process with the Southern Association of Colleges and Schools, Commission on Colleges, and through that process, we are integrating our academic advising for students, ensuring that all students get the assistance they need to persist and to graduate. This fall, we welcome Dr. Carmen Stevenson as our first ever Director of Academic Advising. And I should add that this advising initiative was possible, has been possible, because of a major gift we secured and announced at this very event last year. To add some more good news, this advising initiative got a major boost recently, and I'm very proud to announce, for the first time publicly, that Maryville College has been selected to receive a five-year, $2.25 million Title III grant from the U.S. Department of Education. Yeah, I'll take it. Come on. With this Strengthening Institutions Program grant, we will establish the Building an Ideal Community Project, with IDEAL being an acronym for Inclusive, Diverse, Equitable, and Accessible Learning. This program will meet the needs of our students by creating a student success model with diversity, equity, and inclusion at the forefront. I agree. The funding will allow for the hiring of seven new critical staff positions, also first-year experience programming, and renovations to create a one-stop shop student support center on our campus. Needless to say, this funding will be a true game changer for Maryville College. We were last awarded such a grant in 1999, which transformed the classroom experience through instructional technology. I have no doubt that this new Title III grant will be transformational for us. With all of that said, I'd like to acknowledge the college employees behind this successful grant proposal: Dan Klingensmith, Heather McMahon, Geraldyn Swan, Kathy Sheba, John Berry, Asia Rodriguez, Brittany Washington, and Jawanda Grant. Let's give those folks a hand. Thank you all so much. As we look to the future, a new science center for the college remains a critical need, and I'm pleased to share that we're making real progress in that regard this year. Retired U.S. Senator Lamar Alexander, a Maryville native and son of Maryville College alumni, has pledged his support for an Institute for Environmental Education and the Sciences. Senator Alexander and I are actively working together on building the relationships and securing the funding to make this institute a reality for Maryville College. In fact, next week, a consultant from Princeton University will be here on our campus to assist with our initial planning and vision for this institute. Please stay tuned for more news in the coming year as we work toward our goal of creating a carbon neutral facility with green features that will serve as a cornerstone of our environmental education efforts and outreach to this amazing region at the footsteps of the Great Smoky Mountains. I think that was foothills of the Great Smoky Mountains, but y'all forgive me. A new science center will come with a very big price tag. Most of our initiatives do, especially these days. But many in this room have and are stepping up to make sure that the college is future-proofed, as I often say. This is an incredibly challenging environment for higher education right now, and it is our generous supporters who help us beat the odds every year. The President's report for fiscal year 22-23 is now online. We forewent the printing and mailing this year, but I'm asking all of you to please visit the college's website and read the stories, view the lists, and celebrate the members. Nearly $2 million was given to the Maryville Fund from hundreds of alumni and friends. The theme of this year's publication is partnerships. and I know the stories included within it, will be a reminder to you of just how blessed we are to be located in a region where so many individuals, businesses, and organizations are committed to this college's success. In terms of dollars given and numbers of participants in last year's Maryville Fund, reunion classes last year led the pack. And I'm happy to report that this year's milestone reunion classes are on a very similar track. I'd like to now recognize the generous alumni in these classes who have been so hard at work this year organizing class reunion gifts. Reunion giving for 2023 has exceeded $211,000. Our milestone classes, those celebrating their 40, 50, and 60 year reunions, are responsible for a very significant amount of these totals. I want to specifically mention the class of 1963, with whom I had lunch today, who established an endowed scholarship to benefit Maryville College students. Finally, with the members of the class of 1973, our newest Golden Scots, stand and please, please be recognized tonight. Thank you all so much. Thank you to the class of 1973 who raised almost $50,000 for the Dr. Randolph Shields Appalachia Resources and Studies Endowment, which will fund educational initiatives related to environmental education and sustainability in this region. If you would like to donate to, or if you would like more information about any of these initiatives I mentioned tonight, including that gym floor, please see Susie Booker or me this weekend, or contact us in the coming weeks. We would love to talk with you. Thank you so, so very much, alumni and friends, for coming home, for being here with us tonight, and for supporting this incredibly special college, which has meant so much to so many for over 200 years, and which certainly means so much to each and every one of us. Have a great homecoming weekend, and go Scots. Thank you.
Now that you're up to speed on many of the exciting things happening on campus, it is time for the first musical performances of the evening. Please join me in welcoming Maryville College's three talented ensembles to the stage, The Lassies, The Lads, and Off Kilter.
Starting with The Lads. Singing for you this evening, Sweet Rivers, you will be transported to the banks of the River Jordan as they take us through lush velvet tones, arcing vocal lines, and a current of rhythmic piano, this Sacred Heart tune. And the author of the text, having lived in the hills of East Tennessee, we knew it had to be featured tonight. Under the direction of Dr. Jenny Anderson, class of 05, and accompanied by Chase Hatmaker, class of 2014, please welcome The Lads.
I rise up here to my
You'll now hear The Lassies. Under the direction of Stacey Murphy Wilner and accompanied by Dr. Jenny Anderson, this notable tune has been referred to as a hymn, a spiritual, an Appalachian song. Some believe it was a Native American tribal adaptation of Christian texts. However, we found it to be attributed to George H. Allen in the Slave Songbook of 1867. No matter the original origin of this cherished melody, we can see why it's been passed down through the ages due to its deeply spiritual meaning, keeping faith in times of darkness. You'll now hear from soloists Elena Wilson, Brianna Markopoulos, Dana Patterson, and Emma Holmes. Please enjoy The Lassies. We will now combine the Lads and Lassies to create Off Kilter, our small chamber ensemble under the direction of Stacey Murphy Wilner and accompanied by Chase Hatmaker. You will hear Great God Almighty, a work song by Stacey V. Gibbs that serves as a reminder of the violence and oppression forced upon Black people that is still being experienced to this day. The lyrics tell the experience of being hunted by a slave master while praying to God to be saved from being killed. The powerful ending speaks to the strength to overcome and the desire for freedom. Please enjoy Off Kilter.
The Maryville College Alumni Citation has been awarded to outstanding alumni of the college since 1961. This award may be presented to any alums or alumna who have demonstrated outstanding leadership, initiative, or service in his or her community, church, or profession. This year, we have two incredibly deserving recipients. The first recipient is the 2023 Alumni Citation is Denise Blinky Hines, class of 1980.
Denise Hines' path to Maryville College began on the streets of the Big Apple, with roots that stretch all the way to the Caribbean islands.
Well, I grew up in Brooklyn, New York, in a very intergenerational household with my grandparents, my younger uncles and aunts, my mother, and my brother. My grandparents came here from Trinidad, West Indies.
A favorite uncle passed on his love for basketball, which has been a big part of Denise's life ever since.
For many, many years into my early adulthood, we would play guys on the basketball courts for money. Most of the guys would be like, oh no, we don't want to play against, you know, a girl. We'd end up beating most of the people we played.
The other dominant theme in Denise's young life was the Catholic faith her grandparents brought from Trinidad. Denise was drawn to the women who had given their lives to the church.
I, from a very young age, wanted to become a nun because of some of the close relationships I had with the nuns that I had in elementary school.
When she finished high school, Denise decided it was time for a big change.
First of all, I just knew I needed to get out of Brooklyn. I kind of knew from very early on that I wanted to go away to college.
Denise spent 2 years at a small liberal arts school in the Midwest, where she made friends but experienced racism and struggled to fit in. When an opportunity arose to transfer to Maryville, Denise made the move.
One of the most important people to me at Maryville College was Coach Sharon Brown. We hit it off from day one. I felt that warmth and connection with her immediately on that visit. From that first visit, I knew I was going to go there.
The Scots basketball team became a second home for the new transfer student from New York. And Denise, who stands just 5'2" tall, became the team captain.
We traveled together, we practiced every day together, we hung out at night together. It's just one of those experiences where you get to do the thing you really, really love with really great people. They become your family.
Denise majored in recreation. After graduation, through a connection made at the Maryville College Career Center, she spent a year volunteering as a social worker in a small community outside Dallas, Texas. The experience rekindled her desire to serve God and others and nurtured a seed planted in her heart years before.
Well, I felt the call to become a nun. I guess it started in elementary school with those relationships with those sisters. I never really told many of my friends that that was kind of the direction I was thinking, but it never left me.
When she was 24 years old, Denise took vows and spent the next 13 years with the Sisters of the Good Shepherd, an order of Catholic social workers who operate group homes for children.
I would say, I've had several lives, and being in the convent was one of them, and it was one of the greatest. There were so many things I loved about it, and I was a part of something greater than myself. What caused me to leave the order, I came to the reality that I was lesbian, and I needed to explore that.
Since leaving the convent, Denise has continued her life-changing work with troubled youth, rising to an executive position at Good Shepherd Services in her home city of New York. Her proudest accomplishment is the establishment 19 years ago of the Chelsea Foyer, an amazing program which provides structured, independent living for older teens who might otherwise end up on the street or in trouble with the law.
We're working with people who are struggling to be able to feed their families. They're struggling to keep their families safe from gun violence. We help make communities better, so that we have a generation of young people that can be successful in all the ways that we see that they need to be.
At this stage in her life and career, Denise is also a powerful advocate for other people who want to be accepted for who they are.
Creating safe spaces is really, really important, because that's what allows people to be their true selves. I'm just a normal old person. I'm living my life. I'm serving my community. I'm raising my child. I'm in a relationship. I have a faith base, just like anybody else. And I am a lesbian.
Today, Denise is engaged with Maryville College through the Alumni Diversity Task Force. And not surprisingly, she's as passionate about her alma mater as she is about all of the other causes in her life.
Maryville's in my blood, you know. I hear the school song and I'm like, I just love these words, you know. Noble, grand, and true, you know. People talk about, you know, UT and they bleed orange. Well, I got the orange and garnet in my blood, you know. It's kind of like one of the secret ingredients that's made me who I am, you know, and I'll just be forever grateful.
This on? I'm overwhelmed, to say the least, and I first want to thank the president of the college, Brian Coker, and everyone who thought I was worthy of this honor. Honestly and truly, very humbled at this moment. 40 years ago, when I walked onto the campus, slightly bruised and traumatized by my previous college experience, I never thought I would find a college where I would feel as much at home as I did at Maryville College. Now, I gotta tell you, and this isn't, I didn't write this down, but I gotta tell you that it wasn't perfect. But I certainly didn't have the experiences at Maryville that I had at the college that I went to previously. I owe much of that to Coach Sharon Brown, who encouraged and supported me then and to this day. And I truly appreciate the love and concern that I experienced from her. And I'll just give you one small example. When I was graduating, during graduation, my grandfather became very ill, and my family had planned to fly to Tennessee to be here. But unfortunately, my grandfather passed away that weekend. And none of my family was able to attend my graduation. At the time, I went to the bursar to like finish all my bills and realized that I had some money that would have caused me not to graduate. And two people stepped in. That was Sharon Brown and Margaret Hess, I believe her name was. So I want to just thank both of them for the support and love and support that I received. I also want to thank my teammates, many and friends, many of whom are here tonight. I want to thank them for the friendships that we've made and have continued throughout the years. I love you all, and you know, there's so many stories, so many things that we went through while we were here, and we continue to be a part of each other's lives, and I think that's part of the special sauce of Maryville College, that if you give yourself to other people, you get that back, and I've received that from them. So thank you all. I've also had the good fortune to find work that sustained me for over 40 years, where I've been able to support thousands of young people and their families during some of the hardest times of their lives. I worked with some of the toughest kids, and continue to do so, but I've also had the most powerful moments with those young people and their families, and have learned much more from them than I've given. I consider it all a gift. Many of those young people now that call me weekly or sometimes even daily during their own adult struggles are, you know, in their 40s now. So it's just a powerful experience to see things come full circle. I love Maryville College. I'm proud of how far it has come to be a more inclusive institution. Many people speak it. I do believe that Maryville is continuing to be on a journey and on a path to becoming more inclusive. I'm happy to have the opportunity to be engaged in the work that they're doing by helping the school to continue to create those safe spaces that I talked about for all students by serving on the Alumni Diversity Task Force. Before I end, I also wanted to thank my family who couldn't be with me today, but we all know that, you know, blood family is important, but also having a community of friends that become your chosen family are just as important. But I do miss having my mother here. She's unfortunately struggling with Alzheimer's, and my brother as well, struggling with Alzheimer's in Florida. I am grateful for all that they've done. My mother was someone who has always loved me unconditionally, and I greatly appreciate that because it's allowed me to be the person that I am. And to my partner, Ann, who's here, we met each other late in life, but it's been one of the joys of my life to be with somebody who also loves me so unconditionally and lets me do all these crazy things. And and my daughter, who's now 20, who's absolutely one of the greatest joys of my life. I'm also really, really happy to be involved in my community in New Jersey. Outside of the work, the daily work that I do as a professional, just being involved in community activism and being able to support the LGBTQIA community in New Jersey, especially in those places where it's so critical. We're saving lives every day at work, but we're also saving lives every day by doing the work we do in the community for our young people who are really just struggling to be accepted. And honestly, like, in talking in this video, you know, some people might say, well, why does she have to say that she's a lesbian? I think it's so important because representation matters. It may not matter to someone else, but for me and the work that I do, and even for students that I've had having the opportunity to talk to at Maryville College, for them to see someone who has created this life, it's just a normal life, but it's an important life, and I like to think that it makes a difference so that young people don't have to feel like they have to take their own lives because they don't have the support that they need. So we're out here trying to do the good work, and I think Maryville College, you know, kind of like started me on that path, but as you can see and as you've heard, I think there are a lot of people who've been so inspirational and important to me that have really helped put me on this path. So again, I am incredibly humbled. I thank you so much, Maryville College, for recognizing the work that I do. Honestly, I never really thought about it in this grand way, but you know, I appreciate everything, and thank you.
Our second recipient of the 2023 Alumni Citation is Adam McCall from the class of 1999. Please enjoy his video presentation to learn more about his life dedicated to the great outdoors and entrepreneurship.
Adam McCall grew up on a dairy farm outside Maryville with his parents and two older sisters. From his earliest days, Adam's days on the farm started early.
My mom and dad are my absolute best role models. I was so blessed with having a family that loves each other, has stayed together. We didn't have money. We worked very hard. We did everything together, and it was just good, simple fun.
Much of the time, that fun happened outside, instilling in Adam a love for the great outdoors.
That's what mom and dad really instilled in us from day one, was just the importance of the outdoors, but also just how much fun you can have by, you know, going on hikes and cookouts and campouts. You know, for me as a kid, you know, I had kind of like this massive playground. That's kind of how I saw it. I mean, I used to just spend so much time, you know, riding my BMX bike through the fields, or you know, hiding out, building hideouts in various corners of the fields. And I remember when my mom would punish me, it was usually forcing me to stay in the house.
Not surprisingly, Adam flourished in scouting, earning his Eagle Scout rank. But he also developed a flair for other adventurous hobbies.
By my senior year in high school, I was pretty addicted to three sports by that point: kayaking, mountain biking, and wakeboarding.
These outdoor pursuits played a big role in Adam's decision to apply to Maryville College, which offered easy access to mountains, streams, and lakes. Adam enrolled in a dual degree program that gave him 3 years at Maryville and 2 years at Tennessee Tech, focusing on mechanical engineering. Adam immediately felt at home in a Maryville College program that allowed him to share with others his love for outdoor adventures.
The day I made the decision that I was going to Maryville College, I think, is the day that I also made the decision I'm gonna work on Mountain Challenge staff, because it just, it was such a good fit for me. The influences I got from the people at Mountain Challenge, but also the experience of taking people to the outdoors, almost sort of forcing this dynamic of healthy communication in order to achieve a particular goal. There's no way I can extract on a daily basis what Mountain Challenge has done for me in my career, in my social life, everything about it.
Adam went on to earn an MBA from Tennessee Tech in 2005. His first job after grad school was at Idleair, a company with a cutting-edge idea in the early 2000s.
The idea behind it was a device that can plug into a tractor trailer truck window and allow the truck to not have to idle while the driver is resting. And this device would bring in heating, air conditioning, power, cable TV, video on demand, and high-speed internet.
It was a great convenience for drivers, but also promised to help the environment by eliminating the millions of gallons of diesel fuel burned each year when drivers would otherwise idle their engines to stay comfortable during their stops. Throughout his time at Idleair, Adam continued to indulge his love for competitive wakeboarding. This led to an unexpected opportunity in 2007 to join the executive leadership team at Malibu Boats, where Adam was given the opportunity as founder and managing director of Axis Wake Research Boat Company to create a new line of watercraft. It was Adam's idea to create an affordable line of boats that more people could afford to own.
It was truly a dream opportunity for me. As you can imagine, it incorporates engineering, it incorporates company entrepreneurship, but the oh by the way for me was it incorporates this hobby that is just such an important part of my life.
Adam disrupted the industry again by designing and patenting SurfGate, a device which allows boaters to create optimal wakes for wakeboarders with the flip of a switch. But not surprisingly, this innovative Maryville College grad was not content to rest on his accomplishments.
I guess I get maybe like a 6 or 7 year itch, as best I can tell. It's almost like when things are to a point where I believe that they're stable, that's kind of when my mind begins to wonder, right? Like my mind starts looking for that next problem.
For Adam, the next challenge presented itself when he learned about groundbreaking research UT and Oak Ridge scientists were conducting on new uses for lignin, a byproduct of the paper industry. Adam became president and CEO of Tenera, a subsidiary of the UT Research Foundation. There he spun off a new company called Prisma Renewable Composites, which has formulated usable carbon fibers made from lignin at a competitive price point.
This is a door upper of a particular vehicle, and our material will be replacing ABS plastic in this particular car part.
No matter where his career takes him next, Adam says family and the outdoors remain at the root of his identity. He still hikes and spends time with his parents, his sisters, and their spouses and children. And now the family has grown to include his wife, Mariko.
Growing up on a dairy farm, you know, we didn't have money. But what we had is what I'm now realizing in this world is so rare, and that is, I mean, we had each other. The tears could tell you everything, right? Because it's everything to me.
Believe my reputation exceeds me. You know, it's intimidating getting this, but following Denise is much more intimidating. That's an amazing story. So I thought I would put a few notes on paper that would make me sound smart, but even ChatGPT got stumped. So I'm going to wing it. First and foremost, I want to thank God and my family. I think the video said it all. They're everything. But especially want to thank Mariko. So it's been kind of an interesting career, I guess you could say, and I owe her an apology because when I met her about 10 years ago, we had just taken the boat company public, and you know, things are going good, and I sort of indicated to her that I was ready for a simple life. The 8-to-5, if you will, and in fact, I think I told her that I was going to be a stay-at-home dog dad. And little did she know, she was going to end up having to ride the roller coaster with me and be my absolute rock. And through two biomaterials companies in this last 10 years, a hippie lifestyle clothing brand, a Bluetooth-enabled financial technology company, and a boat dealership. So, honey, I'm sorry about that. And I would tell you that I'm close to being done, but that would be a lie. As for Maryville College, you know, it's hard to explain, you know, honestly, the surprise of how much I loved it. And, you know, don't take offense to that, anybody. It's just that when you're a local, and you know, you go to the college 15 miles down the road, you know, it's the school you'd grown up, you know, hearing about, and your dad worked there, and I just really didn't understand how special, you know, it truly was going to be. And what I saw and what I definitely see to this day is that, you know, the faculty and staff have a love and a true interest for the students that I think is quite rare. And, you know, I won't be able to name all of them, but I definitely want to name, you know, some of the professors that mean so much to me. Dr. Nichols, Dr. Miller, Dr. Naylor, Dr. Bundy, late Dr. Dent, Dr. Threadgill. You know, these people were very special to me, and I will never forget them. In closing, I'm going to try and sum up what Maryville College on the whole is to me. And I'll do it with some verses, a poem, if you will. Bet you didn't see this coming. It will be sold later to the highest bidder for any local third grade poetry contest. It's one thing for a college to teach you the depths of planetary motion and differential equations, but it's an entirely different thing to also teach you French Impressionism and biblical history at the same time. It's one thing for a college to have beautiful grounds where students can hang out between classes, but it's an entirely different thing to have a 500,000 acres in a national park in your backyard. And it's one thing for a college professor to remember your name in class, but it's an entirely different thing for them to call you and check on you when you're sick. Ladies and gentlemen, that's Maryville College, and it's an entirely different thing. So, thank you.
If you haven't heard the Tartan Band play at football games and select home basketball games, you are in for a treat. Put your hands together for the MC Tartan Band. Ladies and gentlemen, we will now have a 20-minute intermission. Please enjoy the snacks and beverages in the foyer, particularly the fine MC Brew provided by Professor Nathan Duncan and his fermentation science students. In the Haslam Family Flexible Theater, here at the Clayton Center for the Arts. Admission is free and the performances are open to the public. Please welcome fellow students, Wade Matthews and Sasha Haney, to the stage for a sneak peek of this outstanding play.
I've lived in Wyoming my whole life. My family has been in Wyoming, well, for generations. Now, when it came time to go to college, my parents couldn't afford to send me to college. I wanted to study theater, and I knew that if I wanted to go to school, I was going to have to get in on a scholarship. And they have this competition each year, this Wyoming State High School competition, and I knew that if I took first place in duets, that I could get a scholarship. So I went to the university, and I'm looking for good scenes, and I talked to one of the professors there, I need a killer scene. And he says, here you go, this is it. And it's from Angels in America. And I read it, and I knew that if I did a good enough job, that I could take first place. And I, when the time came, I sat my parents down. Now you have to understand, my parents, they go to everything. Every ball game, every hockey game, everything I've ever done. And when I sat them down, they told me that they would not come to see me in the competition if I did that scene, because they believed that it was wrong, that homosexuality was wrong. They believed it that much that they didn't want to come see their one son do the most important thing he had done up until that point in his life. And I didn't know what to do. I had never gone against my parents' wishes, so I was a little nervous about it, but I decided to go ahead and do it. And all I can remember about the competition is when we were done, me and my scene partner, we walked up to each other and we shook hands, and there was this standing ovation. Oh man, it was amazing! And my parents weren't there. And to this day, that was one thing they didn't see me do. And I think to myself, like, why did I do it? Why did I oppose my parents? Because I'm not gay, so why did I do it? And I guess the only honest answer I can give is that I wanted to win. It was such a good scene. It was like the best scene. Do you all know Mr. Kushner? Maybe you could tell him about it?
When I saw Fred Phelps protesting at the funeral for Matthew Shepard, and I heard that he was coming to the Laramie trial for Russell Henderson, I decided that somebody needed to stand toe to toe with him and show people the difference. And I think when we're talking about hate, as much as the nation is right now, somebody needs to go out there and show the world that there's a better way to deal with that kind of hate. So our plan is to dress up as angels. And we've designed these angel costumes, for our wings are huge. They are big wings. And there's going to be 10 to 20 of us that are angels. And our plan is to encircle Phelps. And because of our big wings, we are going to completely block him. And so a big old band of angels, like, we come on out, and we don't say a word. We just turn our backs to him, and we stand there. And we are a group of people bringing forth this message of peace and love and compassion, and we're calling it Angel Action. Yeah. This 21-year-old little lesbian is ready to walk the line with him.
Ken Takahashi Award is given to an alums or alumna who has, within 20 years of his or her graduation from Maryville College, lived a life characteristic of college legend Ken Takahashi, who, in his own 36 years, worked tirelessly for the betterment of his alma mater, his church, and his society. Mark Leibel, class of 2003, is the 26th alum to receive this award. Before we hear from Mark, please enjoy this video presentation we have put together in his honor.
The U.S. Capitol may seem a world away from the campus of Maryville College, but for Maryville alumnus Mark Leibel, the move from the hills of Tennessee to the halls of power was almost as straightforward as walking into his office in the Russell Senate office building.
Who do y'all call to make these kind of things happen? Like, if we wanted to...
Currently, Mark serves as chief of staff for Senator Raphael Warnock of Georgia, overseeing more than 50 people who work daily on matters of national importance.
Pull the governor meeting together sooner rather than later as well.
You're one of 100, but each of you has a great deal of influence. You know, it's really exciting and it's really fulfilling.
Over nearly two decades on Capitol Hill, Mark has served in various roles under several lawmakers, including two representatives and three senators, all Democrats. He also played important roles at the Federal Reserve and in the Biden administration's transition team, and even found time to earn two law degrees.
Every job I did, all the mistakes I made, I really do believe we're all in preparation for that moment, and now we get to build something long-term here.
A series of experiences culminating in his years at Maryville College in the early 2000s prepared Mark for the journey that brought him to the halls of political power. You might say the seeds were planted when he was just a child in North Alabama.
I can remember, you know, when I was 5 or 6 years old and first had access to the school library at Forest Hills in Florence, Alabama, they had a series of presidential biographies and books on the White House that I would check out over and over again, even then.
Mark was an introvert who played tennis and other sports, but really found his place on the theater stage, where he learned skills that he still uses today.
It taught me a lot of good skills about collaborating, public speaking, motivation, thinking about the motivations of others. I certainly wouldn't be sitting here in the role I'm in if I had not, you know, been active in theater in high school and college.
Mark brought his love of theater and tennis with him when he came to Maryville College. But Mark's fondest memory of his years as a Scot involved conversations with a favorite professor.
Dr. Klingensmith, Dr. Dan Klingensmith, was incredibly influential to me in, you know, my experience at Maryville. You know, I can't tell you how many afternoons I would spend in his office, he and I, talking about American political history.
After graduation, when Maryville College tennis teammate Chris Hickson got a job in Washington, Mark followed. For a time, Mark slept on the floor of Chris's D.C. apartment while he was looking for work. Then a chance encounter in the halls of Congress fixed Mark's course for the future.
I'd written my undergrad thesis on Bobby Kennedy's 1968 presidential campaign, and I set foot in the Russell Senate office building, and I crossed paths in the hallway with Ted Kennedy. I instantly had that feeling of, I need to be here. You know, this is kind of where, you know, the action is, and I need to give this a shot.
Mark and Chris both still work in Congress and remain close friends, even though they serve on opposite sides of the political divide. Each served as best man in the other's wedding. Mark married his wife, Carrie, who also works for the federal government, 11 years after arriving in D.C. In his work on the Hill, Mark found daily echoes of his time at Maryville College, particularly in cherished conversations with Senator Jones.
The opportunity to have a bourbon with Doug in his office after a vote on a Monday night and talk about life and politics, you know, that was kind of a dream experience, a dream job, and, you know, was a more spirited version. Since there was no liquor involved in the conversations Dr. Klingensmith and I were having, but was kind of the evolution of those conversations, Dr. Klingensmith and I sitting in his office at Maryville talking about life and politics, and now Doug Jones and I sitting there talking about, you know, his career, but political history, everything else there. It was kind of a full circle experience for me.
Now Mark is making history as he helps to build a legislative legacy for Raphael Warnock, the first black senator from the state of Georgia. Mark credits his time at Maryville College, on the theater stage, the tennis court, and the classroom, with building the skills and confidence he needed to reach the heights where he serves today.
Maryville College was a perfect place for me to go. If I'd gone to some big state school, I'd have gotten lost. And, you know, the small campus, forced me to kind of get outside of my comfort zone, develop friendships that I might not have otherwise developed, to be exposed to folks with different viewpoints in ways that I might not have been exposed to otherwise, to get to be able to participate in things like tennis and theater as a freshman.
Mark welcomes the opportunity to help other Scots follow in his footsteps. He recently spoke virtually to a class and freely offers advice and support to any student who asks.
It's been really important to me to find opportunities to give back to Maryville College. I wanted to make sure, you know, for Maryville College students who were thinking about careers in Washington, D.C., regardless of their political persuasion, that I was somebody they could talk to and ask for advice, you know, or practice interview, and talk about the pros and cons of a career here, because it's not for everybody.
For this 2003 Maryville College graduate, orange and garnet run deeper than red or blue.
Thank you, Dr. Coker, the alumni for this award. Thank you, Maryville College. I just want to make sure Dr. Klingensmith's character is not impugned. There were no spirits involved in any of those conversations back then. Spirits may have been involved in subsequent conversations, but that's not for tonight. I don't have to tell the people in this room the value of a liberal arts education. A lot of us are here doing what we're doing because of liberal arts education, because of being able to go to a small school, develop the relationship we had at a place like Maryville. For me, coming from Florence, Alabama, as I said in the video, I would have gotten lost at a state school. No state school would have let me do theater and tennis. And being able to be a part of the theater department, learn to speak in front of people, you know, learn to be present in the moment, you know, it's so essential to what I do every day, what you have to do in this profession. With the tennis team, two of my good friends from the tennis team, Joe Ambler and Chris Hickson, here, the leadership you learn being a part of that, the friendship, the teamwork, that's so important to managing a team. Having an award named after Ken Takahashi, you know, is so meaningful with the legacy that he set of public service. And, you know, for me, being in public service, that inspiration came from my parents, you know, my dad running a community mental health center, my mom as a teacher, the example they set. And when I was looking for a college, a place where I could grow, you know, one of the big things that made Maryville College such an obvious place, besides the opportunity to participate and be part of a community, was how important public service was rooted in things here. I just wanna say quickly, thank you to my wife, Carrie, and her family who are here, her parents, Bonnie and Bruce. Appreciate them being here. My parents, Brian and Lynn, my brother, Adam, for being here, Joe and Chris. To the current students who are here, thank you for sharing your gifts with us tonight. And to the students and faculty, if I can ever be helpful to you, in DC, in my profession, in anything, I look forward to giving back. To the alumni, you know, many of you celebrating the golden anniversaries here, the work that you were giving helped us have the opportunities we had, class of 03, the classes that came after us, so thank you for that, and we look forward to following in your footstep as well. So I'll stop there, and thank you all again.
Organized initially in 1917 to sing Vesper services, the Maryville College Concert Choir has had a long and rich tradition. Today, Concert Choir members serve as a musical ambassadors for the college, touring domestically and internationally. Performances throughout this year will include tonight's performance, Handel's Messiah, Spring Homecoming Concerts, the Knoxville Opera's Rosani Festival, and performances at area churches and other events in the community throughout the year. Please welcome your 2023 Maryville College Concert Choir.
The Maryville College Concert Choir, directed by Stacy Murphy-Wilner and accompanied by Chase Hatmaker, will perform two pieces for you this evening. Featuring trombonist Gabe Hatcher, they will begin with In Remembrance by Jeffrey Ames. This piece was written during a time of great sadness for Ames, as it was composed in response to the death of one of his high school students and their parent due to a tragic car accident. He said, "I believe In Remembrance carries a message of healing, peace, and hope. It reflects my sadness, for I know I will never see the smiling faces of those I've lost again, but it also reflects my joy, for I know they are at rest, and I will one day see them again in heaven." We would like to dedicate this performance to the memory of all MC alumni, staff, faculty, students, friends, and family that are no longer with us. May their memory be a blessing. We will now hear In Meeting We Are Blessed. This Gesnazzo text, inspired by John Donne, speaks to themes of friendship and unity, which we can all relate. We are met together, and in meeting we are blessed. Peace in coming and in going, peace in labor and in rest. Featuring percussionist Amber Nejmi Hatmaker, class of 2016 on the djembe, and Chase Hatmaker on the rainstick, along with choral movements from our ensemble, we hope that you will feel as blessed as we are by having met together this evening. The Maryville College Homecoming Choir is a musical force. Combining the voices of choir alumni with current MC choir students, you are in for a treat. They will begin with two spirituals, William Dawson's Suna Will Be Done, and Moses Hogan's I'll Make the Difference, which will feature 2012 alum soloist Dr. Donald Rucker, a recent winner of Fulbright Scholarship and holding a doctorate in educational leadership. It is no surprise to hear that he is truly changing the lives of students as he leads KIPP Vision Academy in Atlanta, Georgia as their principal. Though his focus is on education, you'll no doubt realize that music is also a passion of his and that we are delighted to have him with us this evening. Our guest conductor this year is Sean P. Turner. Sean has been around music and choirs his entire life. He holds a Bachelor of Music degree in Jazz Studies from the University of Tennessee, Knoxville, where he marched in the Pride of the Southland Band and participated in various UT choirs. He then received his teaching certificate from here in 2014 and made positive waves in the lives of his students. He felt a calling to turn to full-time church ministry and now proudly serves as the choir director and keyboardist at Sevier Heights Baptist Church. He is also an adjunct professor at the University of Tennessee College of Music, where he is serving as director of the UT Gospel Choir. Please join me in welcoming our 2023 Homecoming Choir conductor to the stage, Sean Turner.
the difference, yes. I will make the difference against all odds. I will live to share my love with others, oh yes. I will make the difference. I can make it. Take my hand as we make this journey across the Take my hand as we make this journey across the land. I've had the courage to keep holding on. I've had the faith when all hope was gone. I've had the strength to keep holding on. Oh, yes. Take my hand as we make this journey. I've had the courage to keep holding on. I've had the faith when all hope was gone. I've had the strength to keep holding on. Take my hand as we make this journey. We're the ones, yes, we're the ones. Said we're the ones. Said we're the ones. Take my hand as we make this journey across the land. Said we can take my hand.
Now we'll hear the Hallelujah Chorus from Handel's Messiah, which you can hear again at the conclusion of the Fine Arts Division's Christmas performance of the work on December 5th by the combined talents of the Maryville College Concert Choir, Community Chorus, Orchestra, and Heritage High School Singers. This is our way of kicking off the countdown to that event and reminding you to keep your eyes peeled for tickets to go on sale through the Clayton Center for the Arts box office. They'll then close this set by singing Peter Ludkin's Benediction and Amen, a tradition that has been proudly carried through the years. When you join in singing the Ludkin and MC, you're joining the many generations of voices that came before and will continue after you. May the Lord bless and keep us indeed.
Thank you for joining us for this evening's Founders Day Showcase and celebrating our accomplished alumni and talented students. I encourage you to take a look at the back of your programs to see all those individuals and entities who have helped make tonight such a joyful experience. On behalf of the Maryville College community, I hope you have a wonderful and memorable homecoming weekend, and thank you for allowing me to be your MC. Now I ask you to stand and join the homecoming choir and the MC Tartan Band in the singing of our alma mater. The Tartan Band will continue to play the fight song as you exit the theater. Thank you again, and have a terrific night.